get a familiar face again. Awesome. It's been too long. But I would like to start out by thanking Tommy and Grand Nest and the establishment for letting us use this awesome room. Thank you very much. I also like to thank Joel Diamond for the work of the video and pictures and our support. And the last minute, Brianna Diamond stepped in to videotape this. So we always have it as a memory. Thank you, Brianna. You're the best. I also like to thank my family and my friends for supporting and holding me up. Sorry. This is a difficult time. And thank you to Benny's amazing fans for always supporting me. Sorry. I remember the night we met. It was at a Christmas party 12 years ago. And I basically didn't want to go because I just lost a friend to pancreatic cancer. And I heard later that Benny didn't want to go. Marty, you convinced him and told him he at least would get a good meal. So either one of us wanted to go to that party. I had a feeling it was meant to be. I heard later that, we had great time. I didn't know who Benny was. So he sat down by the host of the party, asked him to go in the piano room. And he was a little reluctant, but he finally got up and got into the piano room. And he played a song that I'd never heard. But I thought he plays pretty good piano, yeah. And everybody was clapping. And all of a sudden he hears this, do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do. I was like, wait a minute. I arrived in this country in 1980 from Europe. Obviously, it was on the radio all the time, so I knew the song. And I turned to my friend, I was like, did he write that song? And she was like, yeah, he wrote that song. I was like, okay, impressive. But anyway, you know how much confidence Benny had. Full of it. And I heard later that in the car home, he told Marty that that's the woman I'm going to marry and live with for the rest of my life. He was right again. Go figure. He took my kids in as his own, and they all loved him. He adored our grandchildren and loved spoiling them. A little over the top. We became a family right away. If people didn't know who he was when he walked in a room, they would damn sure know who he was when he walked out. There was no doubt about that one. He was just fun. He was also he had a heart of gold. And if he heard about a fan who had a problem, he would be the first one to reach out and try to help them in any way he could. He also, as you know, had numerous of fundraising shows for breast cancer and Parkinson's disease. And he was in awe of science and he wanted to help to try to find cures for these horrible diseases. So he did quite a bit of that. I'm so sorry. I remember one trip, one of numerous trips coming back from Syracuse, New York. You know, Benny, he would get into a plane and he would, boom, headphones on, and no talking, no nothing. He was really not a fun travel companion at all. On this particular trip, this young man sits down next to me, and across the aisle was another young man with a service dog, beautiful German Shepherd. So we really got to talk about because of this beautiful dog. And I said, so what's the story? And they had been in Iraq and Afghanistan, and this poor kid suffered terribly from PTSD, and he had not gotten the help that he needed. And he was basically suicidal, very depressed. So lo and behold, we get home, and Benny contacts a congressman in Syracuse and asks him to find the right help for this young man. And we didn't really hear much back. 2 months later, we had a phone call with his wife sobbing on the phone. And we were like, oh God, oh, he committed suicide. And she was like, she was thanking Benny for saving her husband's life. That was Benny in a nutshell. So finally, I'd like to say Ruben Amon, AKA Benny Matons. I love you. Always and forever. And with that, I would like to thank my God.
Together. This is amazing. It's a shame we couldn't have done this a year ago. I really didn't prepare anything because I've been at a loss for words for the last year, and I don't know what to say. This shit has broken my heart, and I just want to say thank you to everybody that's been here, the phone calls. My brother has been there by my side, my mom, every step of the way. I'm sorry, I don't have more to say, because I'm still really hurting. This is really painful. And we've seen the beautiful footage of my dad, and everything has been great. But I would give anything to give that guy one more hug and just be able to play around and golf with him, with our best friends, and you know. But God, man, he would be so happy to see all you guys here. I mean, everybody. I was kind of dreading this, because I thought it was going to be very emotional and very hard for me, but I was pleasantly surprised walking through that door. I mean, Joel, thank you. Tommy, Luann, everybody that's been a part, Ed, Tommy D, I mean, you guys made this a celebration of life as opposed to a memorial service. So let's fucking celebrate Benny Mardones, huh?
The year was 1969. At MRC Music, in New York City, and that was my first full-time job in the music business. And it's also a breeding ground for some great talent to come. Janice Siegel from Manhattan Transfer is one of our writers. Bobby Flax is one of our writers who went on to be president of Sony Music. Alan Bernstein, a writer who wrote After the Loving for me for Engelbert, that I produced. Don Oriolo, who built a mega empire of from Felix the Cat. And of course, Benny Mardones. Benny came off the bus from Savage, Maryland, and I don't know why or how the first stop he made was my office. And this is, this is all new to me too. I mean, I was cutting my teeth for the first time in the music business. That was my first job, first full-time job. But I had known about 2 months in I needed help because we had so many writers. So somebody called me and they said, is the guy looking for a job? He'd be a great assistant to you. I said, okay, who is he? He said, well, he was an artist on Epic Records. And he went under the name of T.D. Valentine. Okay? So I said, okay, I'll meet him.
What was T.T. short for? Do we know?
No idea. Okay, all right. No, good question. No idea. And it was Tommy Mottola, who became the longest running president of Sony, married to Mariah Carey, and so on and so forth. So when Benny walked into the office, Tommy was in my office at the time. And Benny just walked into the secretary. He said, I want to see the guy who runs this company. I want to sing for him. And she said, okay. So Benny came into my office, me and Tommy were sitting there, and he started singing. I said, oh my God, amazing. So that was Benny's first audition. I gave him a job immediately as his writer. I hooked him up with another writer who was at MRC already named Alan Miles, and they wrote their asses off. They did a great job. Alan's wife, Nina, can we acknowledge her, Nina? So tonight, Benny was certainly multifaceted, wouldn't you all agree? There was Benny, the voice, and probably each one of you would relate to one of these Bennies. There was Benny, the renegade. There was Benny, the father. And how lucky Michael Everett was to have a role model who taught Michael, amongst other things, that when a friend is in trouble, don't annoy him by asking him if there's anything you could do. Think up something appropriate and just effing do it. And there was Benny the uncle. He was an uncle to my Brianna, my daughter, and a lot of other people, and you know, 80s children refer to him as Uncle Benny. And there was Benny the impressionist. Did anybody ever see Benny do any of his impressions? Oh my God, he was great. He was great. And then of course, there was Benny the husband. So in love with Jane. For me, personally, there was Benny, my friend, for 50 years. 50 years. And he taught me a lot of things along with you, Michael. And I remember Benny saying to me, he said, as you get older, your friends become your family. And remember that in prosperity, our friends all know us. But in adversity, we know all our friends. Which I thought was pretty interesting. Benny introduced me to Woodstock, New York. When I lived in Manhattan for 20 years, after he introduced me to Woodstock, New York, I rented a house every single summer up there. It was beautiful, I loved it. And needless to say, Benny was the hometown hero up there. Everybody knew him, everybody loved him. You know something? Life has a beginning and life has an end for all of us. And one thing that will always be said of Benny Mardones is that he squeezed the tube of life completely dry. One year ago today, Benny made the most unselfish, ultimate sacrifice by donating his body to science to help him find the cure for Parkinson's. Benny, Benny, Brianna and I love you more than you could ever know and will always cherish our memories that we had with you. Rest in paradise, and may your soul rest in peace forever. A superstar in his own right, with a huge, huge recording career. And I'd like to introduce the co-writer of Into the Night, Robert Tepper.
Take you into the night, show you change our lives, me and Ben. You know, my son, as I was leaving, he said, so what are you doing, Dad? So I'm going to Benny's memorial. And like Joel said, Uncle Benny's memorial. And he was Uncle Benny to all my kids. And he said, so basically you're going to sing My Way at Frank Sinatra's funeral. I said, something like that. So everyone, as everyone said, from the moment you met Betty, you knew something unordinary was happening, right? You know, whether he could take you into the night, he could lift you up, whether any of that was true, it really didn't matter. Because once you jumped on the Magical Mystery Tour with Benny, it was a whole different story, okay? I used to call Benny an Olympic event, right? He was so damn competitive, man. Where are we going? We're going to Brooklyn to Eddie Pasquale's house. We're going to play darts. We're going to play a couple of games of darts? No, we're going to play about 17 games of darts. Okay. What are we doing here, Benny? We're making a record in Florida. Well, we're going to play some frisbee golf. Frisbee golf? Really, Benny? I don't think ESPN has frisbee golf. We're going to play frisbee golf, and we're going to be good at it, right? All right, we'll play frisbee golf, you know, and then we're at Turtle Creek, we're rehearsing, and we're playing croquet every day. So, I mean, the man was a competitor, without a doubt. He was, you know, right? He loved to compete, man. She's just 16 years old. Leave her alone, they say. Separated by fools that don't know what love is yet. But I want you to know, if I could fly, I'd pick you up and take you into the night and show you what love. For at least a couple of nights, Benny all of a sudden looks at me and I'm vulnerable. He goes, "She's just 16 years old. Leave her alone," they say. I go, "Yeah, man." I said, "That's so. What do you think happened?" So I was sitting there, and this girl, who really pretty, really, really pretty. Can you see me over there? I'm sorry. I'm coming back to you. So bad. So this really, really pretty girl comes up, and she was walking Zanky. Zanky the dog. Zanky was this dog that she came up to walk every now and then. And I must have made some inappropriate remark about her age and about who she is. And then we were off to the races, right? This is it. You know, she's just 16 years old. And, okay. Sting says, "Don't stand so close to me," right? Gary Puckett sings, "Young girl, get out of my life," right? And Benny goes, "She's just 16 years old," and the whole fucking world's heads just pop off, okay? I mean, he's right? You know, he's a Southern rocker. Isn't rock irreverent? Isn't, you know, aren't you supposed to be irresponsible? Isn't rock supposed to be wrong, you know? I wrote this down, you know, because this is what Into the Night means to me, okay? And this is going to be hard, okay? I get why people see it's wrong, but Benny was a rockin' rebel, man. Getting canceled way before it was popular to get canceled. At the end of the day, whatever you think that song means, the song is a promise. It's a personal promise from Benny to everybody. That he's going to take you into the night. He's going to show you more love than you ever had in your life. And he's going to take care of you and protect you. That's what that song is about. Not "She's Just 16 Years Old." So fuck all you 16-year-old crazy. Sorry, dude. It had to be said, okay? Get asked that question every goddamn interview. Joe calls me up. "Hey, we gotta change this line, man. This guy don't like this line. Don't do this song." No, I'm kidding. So, all right. So Benny, in every sense of the word, he was my cool older brother. How did I meet him? You know, I'm taking a voice lesson in New York City, and Benny comes rolling in a fur coat with Neil Bogart, right? And they're like, not like a little fur coat, not like some piece of shit, man. This thing looked like he just came back from Alaska. So, and, you know, and the coat's beautiful, and they look like superhumans, you know, and I think the guy who was with Neil Bogart didn't live that long, did he? I think something happened. He had a really, like an independent guy, right? He had one of the first independent labels. And as fast as they walked in, Jane, that's how fast they left, right? He was gone. And the voice teacher says to me, "Hey man, you should write with that guy." I said, "I should?" I mean, me, I was scared of everything, right? I was scared of everything. Benny never seemed scared of anything, right? The closest I had to having any success at all was I had written a song for Paul Anka, okay? So pretty much I had written one bar mitzvah song for some singer, and Benny said, "Do you want to write?" Okay? He must have sensed something important was going on because, you know, we wrote three songs, "Might Have Been Love," "Too Young," and, you know, "It's Like Having a Dream." Nobody has a heart. It's like having it all, watching it fall. I said, "We got all our supplies. We got the marching powder. We got the dust. We got everything we need." "Yes. We're going up to Polygram. We're going to play this for Stu Fine." I said, "Okay." We get to the thing, and then, "Oh, it's fine, good man." I mean, full out, full board, doing it all right there. You know, it was great. Stu was great. He said, "Bobby, we just wrote the first single. Write again, B. You were right again. You did right." Okay, so here we are, we're in Syracuse, and for the first time we run into Tommy Nast, who, you know, radio guys always amazed me because we would party really hard, but we always got back on the bus and went to sleep. They had another band just coming in, and just keeping up with Tommy was, you thought Benny was done, keeping up with Tommy was even harder, man. I was like, "Oh, I'm out of my league here, you know." So here we are, we're in Syracuse, and all of a sudden we're on stage, right? And I look up, and Benny has left the stage. He is now climbing up into the auditorium. He's hanging from the rafters. And I did a lot those days, you know, hanging around Benny. But something happened, and this guy just took over the room. He took over the goddamn room, and there was no turning back. I mean, it was fucking nuts. People were going fucking nuts. And I know Syracuse was his home, and I know he played here a million times, but that was the birth of it, right, Tommy? I mean, that was the birth of it right there. I mean, we got out of there, and he said, "You know, how's it feel to be like the Rolling Stones?" I said, "I don't know, but this is amazing, right?" Okay, I'm almost done. I'm sorry to make this so long.
Take your time.
You know, I had to shorten this thing, too. All right, so here I am, you know, we're in the latter years of his life, right? How long did he have Parkinson's? 8 years? 9? 17?
Yeah.
Fuck, sorry. But here he is, you know, I mean, this is my cool older brother, and I'm looking at him, and I'm going, you know, what's happening to him, man, right before my eyes? What the fuck is going on? And we get together, we even did some writing towards the end. We wrote a really cool song, "Looking for the Love," that Joel knows. And, you know, I give him a call, and I say to him, "You know, Benny, you know, I just want to tell you how much you inspired me, you know. And I just wanted you to be sure that you know that I love you, you know. And that, you know, And he said to me, excuse me, he said, stop. And he said, stop. He goes, I go, why? He goes, am I going to die? Because I'm having a pretty good game, you know? I said, you know. So he had that fight, you know what I mean? He had that fight. He just kept going, you know? So it's a party sentiment, all right? Everybody.
Hi everybody, Tommy James here. Well, I just want to say I am so happy that Benny Mardones is being honored and appreciated in this way. I had the privilege and honor of working with Benny back in the 70s at Columbia Records. I produced several songs for him, and he was an amazing talent, an incredible singer. But he was also a great songwriter. And he and his partner back then, Alan Miles, wrote some beautiful music. And I was so honored to work with him back then. I also was so saddened to hear about his passing when he died. And I will miss him terribly, but I'm also very happy that he's being honored and appreciated in this very special way.
One.
Hello, my name is Bill McGathy. I am the owner, president of IndieGoot Entertainment and McGathy Promotions in New York City. The best thing I can say about my dear, dear friend Benny Mardones is that if there wasn't Benny, there couldn't have been me. When I came to New York in the late 70s, he helped me find an apartment. I helped him get a record deal. Then we made the album, which Into the Night was on, and the rest is history. I loved Benny. No one could make me laugh the way he could. No one could make me cry the way he could. He had the light. If you were in his orbit, you enjoyed it, you were enraptured, you couldn't escape it. He was amazing, a one of a kind. And I would like to say that I think of him every single day. I miss him every single day, but he will always be with me in my heart and in my mind. His light shines on. His music lives forever. He had a lot of great friends, but I'm very proud to say I think that I was special to him and he was special to me. I would love to tell you a story. But I think the story is that when we went to Max's Kansas City and Willie DeVille walked in, and it was during the bad old days, like I said, the late 70s, I said to Benny, hey, do you think Willie's holding? And Benny said to me, Popcorn? He liked to call me Popcorn. Popcorn, the only thing he brought was his habit. Benny Mardones, ladies and gentlemen. He'll live forever.
Good evening. John Moyer Bundy here. I'm so sorry I couldn't be with you all this evening, but I want to let you know I am there with you all in spirit. So please, everyone, let your love light shine. Let it shine brightly. And I really... I want to thank Ben for all he's done for me over the years. He was not only my friend, he was my brother. And I know if he was here today, he would tell you all that he loves you all from the bottom of his heart. I can hear him now. I love you all from the bottom of my heart. So everyone, please embrace one another and enjoy each other's company tonight with a celebration of life for our good friend, my brother, Benny Mardones.
Hi, Kelly McMick here. I just wanted to say that your energy and electricity is so missed here on this planet. I didn't know how I was going to get through this today, but I wanted to just say thank you so much, Benny Mardones, for over 40 years of my life, of having the best times of my life. Miss you so much. I'm glad you're not suffering, though. A lot of us miss you.
Hi, everybody. I'm Kenny Landrum, and thanks for having me here at this celebration of life for Benny Mardones. I was the keyboard player on Never Run, Never Hide, including, of course, Into the Night. And Benny was one of the greatest singers I ever heard. I'll never forget how when we would come to rehearsal and we'd just be rolling out of bed and he'd ask me to give him a high B and he'd hit that that high B on the beginning of She's So French perfectly every time, never cracking, never missing it. When I was introduced to Benny, I wrote down my name and phone number on a piece of paper, and below it I wrote the word Prophet because I had recently gotten a Prophet 5 synthesizer, which was kind of a new thing at the time. And Benny held on to that thing for years and used to tease me about it, how I was supposed to be a genuine prophet because it said so on the note. I think the last time I saw him was when we did the song Fool for Falling in Love, which we recorded in, I think, 2001 in New Jersey. But we had done the demo in my apartment 20 years earlier with Robert Tepper, and he had written the song with Robert and Roy Orbison, who unfortunately never got to record it, but I got to see him, Roy Orbison, that is, through Benny. And that song we recorded 20 years later, and he still had the cassette demo of what we had done 20 years earlier. It was remarkable. One of the things I'll always have to thank Benny about for is being one of the first people to hire me to do an entire album worth of, just for showing that kind of confidence in me. And so wherever you are, Benny, rock on.
Hi, everybody. This is Dwayne Evans. I'm sending this out to all you fans of Benny Mardones in this memorial service because, you know, not only did Benny and I work together professionally, but, you know, Benny became one of my closest friends and associates. I'll miss him greatly. Maybe not as much as some of you, but Benny and I had a wonderful relationship. We worked together since 1980. I think that makes it a 41-year relationship. I can't really believe that when I think about that, but Benny was such a great person, but he was also just a warm-hearted, authentic man, and his journey through the music business is a lesson for everybody. It should... Maybe I'll write a book about it. I don't know, but you know, he taught me an awful lot, and I'll never forget it. Maybe I can pass it on, but you know, one of the great things about Benny that I'll remember is he was such a competitive guy. He was, you know, he played squash. I don't even know what that is. He used to talk about it all the time. But when we were getting ready to go out on tour in 1980. We had a croquet course, a badminton course. We had touch football. We had softball. So, like, every day when we weren't getting ready to go tour, we were competing against one another. That was really fun, and a lot of cool friendships were made. But then after we toured in 1980, I picked up golf. Encouraged Benny to pick up the game of golf. He came to live with me in South Carolina while we wrote songs for his next album. And he just fell in love with the game of golf. And I'll never forget when I was in Beverly Hills in 1989 to do the Blue album. We went to, I think it was the Bel Air Country Club, and he said that Clint Eastwood was a member. And it was a beautiful day, you know, in Southern California, and we teed off. I was better than him, you know, because I'm younger, better looking, and whatever you want to think. And we got to the end of the game. I was probably one of my 7 or 8 strokes. He brought out a doobie on like the 15th hole, but he'd been smoking doobies all the time. And he said, "Hey, Deuce, man, you got to try this thing." And because I was not a pot smoker, and but anyway, he convinced me to smoke some pot to finish the round. And by the next tee box, I was on my knees laughing at him so hard, because we had so much fun together. He knows how to have fun. He knew how to have fun. He knows how to work. We worked. We wrote some of the most beautiful music together. I'll always be proud of it the rest of my life. I'll always be proud of my relationship with Benny. And I'll always also be proud of all you guys in Syracuse and what you meant to Benny and how much you meant to me as well. And, you know, God bless you. God bless Benny. God bless America. He was a great patriot. Served in the Vietnam War. He was in the Navy. Was a radio man. He loved America. And so do I. And I hope you do as well. Good night, everybody.
Celebration of life for my buddy Benny Mardones. I played guitar on the entire Never Run, Never Hide record and Into the Night. Only two solos are not me on that entire record, and it was one of the most memorable times of my life, and I loved Benny, as everybody did. One of the best singers I've ever been with, and I've been with Steve Winwood and Frankie Previn and all sorts of incredible singers, and Benny was the guy. Bobby! He would go, "Bobby! Bobby, I can see you on the other side of that aisle. Bobby, what are you doing here in Woodstock?" I moved to Woodstock and hadn't seen him for years, and I heard that voice, and there was Benny. There he was, man. And I miss him, and we all miss him. And, you know, despite the fact that maybe we weren't in touch all the time, we love this guy. And Jane and Joel and everybody and the family, I send my best wishes. And one of the proudest moments of my life was playing on that record. And God bless you wherever you are. I'm sure you're looking down going, "Marty, Kenny, Sandy, what are you doing? Come on, let's play. Lee, you finally made it." Have a great time. Please honor this incredible artist with this incredible voice that wrote these incredible songs. And I wish I could be there. Thanks so much.
Hi, I'm Ronnie Lynch, and I wanted to be a part of Benny's celebration of life with all of you. Me and my family are from Florence, South Carolina, and we're not going to be able to attend the actual celebration. So when I found out through Facebook we could do this video talking about Benny for a couple of minutes, I jumped at the chance so I could be there in spirit with all of you, if nothing else. So much I could say about Benny and how him and his music has inspired me over the years, being a musician and singer myself. But I want to start with Into the Night. You know, Into the Night is one of those songs, I don't care who you are, even if you didn't know Benny's name at the time, you've heard that song, whether it be on the radio, maybe you've seen the music video years ago. Somewhere along the lines, you've heard that song, or you've heard somebody else listen to it, and you had to think to yourself, "Oh man, that's beautiful and catchy." Cause it's a very catchy song, and it was a big hit for Benny. You know, it definitely helped get him on the map and got him known. I was one of those growing up, always heard the song. My parents liked it a lot. You hear my dad jamming on it. You hear it on the radio. It still plays on the radio today. I'll wake up some mornings, you know, even now, and it's playing on the local radio, you know. It wasn't until about 6 or 7 years before Benny passed that I was listening to Into the Night, and I was getting caught up on some live shows that some clips I seen on YouTube, you know, Benny's still out there doing it, even with his health problems, you know. I thought to myself, I can't believe I haven't listened to a lot more of his stuff over the years. So I went back and listened, and so many other songs besides Into the Night I fell in love with. Some of those are Sheila C., How Could You Love Me?, I never Really Loved You at All. I Started a Joke, the Bee Gees cover that he did, which he did an amazing job on. So much good stuff. My daughter, who's 16 years old, she's just 16 years old. Anyway, she fell in love with his music, Into the Night, and Sheila C. are two of her favorites. She loves singing Into the Night on karaoke. We've done that a few times together. So he also inspired the younger generation, and I'm sure there's a lot more of them out there besides my daughter. So I just want to say to all of you, thank you for letting us do this and be a part of Benny's celebration of life in some way. I wish I could be there to meet all of you, Jane Mardonis and the whole family, Benny's whole family. I wish I could be there to be with you all, but I want to wish all my condolences from my family to yours. And until we meet Benny again, the memories and the music will last forever. Thank you very much. I'm Ronnie Lynch.
Take 1,199. 3 minutes is not enough to say everything that I need to say. The passing of a loved one is often accompanied by a flood of tears and a million regrets. The passing of Benny Mardonis for me was not filled with many tears or any regrets. Let me explain. After the initial tears, I don't think I cried much more. Certainly I miss him every day, but my friendship with Benny was a joyous one, and there are absolutely no regrets. Every time I think of him now, I smile. Benny was one of those people who was larger than life. He had savoir-faire and charisma. He was also a warrior. Benny nicknamed me Marley, and it stuck. My husband wonders who people are talking about when they call me Marlene. He also called me Agent 99, a reference to Get Smart. Whatever he needed to know, whatever he wanted done, I was happy to assist. I am blessed to be counted among his inner circle. We were confidants. I didn't know at the time that I met him how important this man would become to me, how much of a friend, brother, and father, all wrapped up in one, he would be. Benny gave me experiences and opportunities I never dreamed of having. He never ended a phone call without saying, I love you. In my eyes, there is no better than Benny Mardonis. He is the best there is, the best there was, and the best there ever will be. Jane, my heart goes out to you. I could not have chosen a better wife for him if I had chosen myself. I'm so glad that we're friends, and I love you so much. Michael, your father adored you, and he loved you. You have no idea how much. You might think you do, but you don't. You saved his life. We're all better people for having known him.
Hello, everyone. I'm Buck Kelly, and I was one of the lucky guys that got to be one of Benny's best friends for the last 35 years of his life. And first of all, I want to say thank you to all of you here today for a celebration of Benny's life. And I want you to know that each and every one of you made a difference in his life. I want you to know that you made his journey in life a wonderful one. And through your acts of kindness and friendship and of love, you made a difference in his life. You all gave him strength when he needed it. And I want you to know that you, when you talked to him, when you met him, you were the most important person in his life. And that's just the way it is. Because he had that gift, the gift of what we learned to call Mardonis magic. 35 years, we saw the good and the bad in life. The peaks were high, and they were wonderful, and they were great, and they were a lot of fun. Touring the country and seeing this great country of ours, this proud U.S. veteran of the Navy, the Vietnam War, and the SSS Springfield, would take us on his journey of life and introduce us to magical moments that were created on stage and that were created in this journey of life. He was a remarkable individual, a great man. And the one thing I want to say is that as great as a singer as he is, was, and will always be, he was even better as a friend. If you counted Benny Mardones among your friends, you were indeed a blessed individual. He was a great man who always seemed to have the right words of encouragement when a valley and low point in your life would hit you. And he always seemed to know when to call when you needed an encouraging word. He is and will always be an American original. He will be often imitated. He will never be duplicated. Because you can't duplicate that beautiful voice that was touched by the finger of God. But just as importantly, you can't touch his heart and his soul and his ability to love and to forgive. Was second to none. You know, we'd be out on the stage, traveling the country and all, and for 35 years, we were basically 16-year-old kids, whether it was Joe, Eddie, Tommy, Michael, David, all those of us around him. We were 40, 50, 60 years old at the time, but we were all 16-year-old kids. And we loved it. We loved every minute of it. Whether we were playing bocce in the hallways of fine hotels, whether I was driving him 193 miles an hour in a Viper and having him grip the Viper saying, "What the hell's going on, Kelly? What the hell are you doing?" I said, "Benny, we're only going 193. He goes, "Damn it, Mike, I'm on the upswing. I got another hit record. Slow down." Well, we slowed down. The dashboard was damaged, naturally, because he had a grip of strength of 10 men. So that was another great story about him. But he always cared about people. You see, he never took a night off. He never took a song off. And even when Parkinson's would come knocking on his door in the early 2000s, he continued not to take a night off, not to take a song off while on stage. He always felt that somebody new was coming to watch him sing. And yes, there were rough nights. There were nights that were better than others. And then, like a phoenix, he would rise from the ashes and deliver a night like we were back in the 80s. This man with Mardones magic would bring love and kindness to all of us that had the pleasure of listening to his music and all of us who were lucky enough to be his friend. Like I said, he will never be duplicated, and he is an American original. Much like his friends Roy Orbison, Johnny Cash, and others, and many in this room, he can't be imitated again the right way. He loved his mother. He was a good son. I remember when he flew into New York, I picked him up and brought him to the nursing home after her surgery. And we went into a conference room and there was a piano there. And he sat down at the piano, his mother in his wheelchair, and he asked, "Mama, do you want me to play for you?" "Sure, son. I love your music. And I love you." And that day, in that moment, he would always say was the best concert of his life. I want all of you to say, thank you, Benny. Thank you, Jane. Thank you, Michael. To Louise and Charlie and the Mardonas family, I thank each and every one of you for being part of his life. Long live Benny. May he live in your heart. God bless you all and have a wonderful day. Thank you.
Hi, my name is John Lawler, and I was great friends with Benny Mardonas. I actually met Benny in California, and we ended up going to a restaurant. It was with his keyboard player and his wife, Jane, and I just felt like I had known Benny my whole life. And our friendship remained all the way till the day he passed. One of my favorite stories is I invited Benny to Arizona, and I thought we would have a working vacation. And so he and Jane and his dog Roxy and Robert Tepper all came up, and we had a great time and so many memories. But one of my favorite memories of that whole time, and to show the kind of person Benny was, is we went to this diner, and Benny loved the diner. And we were all laughing, and the bill came. And I grabbed the bill and I said, "I got this. You're my friends." And Benny looked at me and he said, "I'm taking this bill. And I got news for you, we're still gonna be friends." That's the kind of man he was. He loved his country, he loved his wife, he loved his friends, and he loved his fans. And as I put on my band site, the world lost an incredible singer-songwriter, but I lost a dear friend. Until we meet again.
Go into the night, that heavenly night. There's another angel walking into the light. Now I can remember this wonderful day. Benny called me and he sang happy birthday. Since high school, I was a fan. Thanks to Joel Diamond, I met the band. Having him in my life, that was a bonus. Rest in peace, Benny Mardonas.
We're about to do open mic. Before we do, I'd like to acknowledge and thank Luann Nast. If it wasn't for her, we wouldn't be here. She made this dream come true for today for all of us. And as the first open mic, I'd like to introduce her better half and a friend to all of us. And love Benny very much, Tommy Nast.
We love you. We miss you. You're in our hearts and souls forever. Great to see everybody. Thanks for coming.
Hi, everybody. I'm Rocky Papelli. My background is nothing like your guys'. I was a professional athlete my whole career. I grew up in Des Moines, Iowa, and I fought guys like Mike Tyson, Larry Holmes, Buster Douglas. And the first time I ever met Benny was with Joel, like most of you, Joel, like brought everybody together. And we were sitting in a restaurant in Beverly Hills, and Jack Lemmon and Walter Matthau were sitting in a booth, like two booths away. And I was sitting next to Benny Mardonas, man. Fuck those guys, I don't even know that. And, I gotta say, man, Benny was my hero. This might be inappropriate, but Benny got me laid more times than that song, man, did it. I swear to God, when you pop that record inside of, you know, and it broke the ice, it broke the ice. I'm telling you, man, that guy, I told you that, too, and he laughed. I was wearing a diamond ring that my grandfather gave me at the restaurant there. And Joel and Benny both kind of helped me survive in California because I was a country boy from Iowa, Italian guy from Des Moines. It's like never, you know. I moved out here to follow my dream as a fighter, and it was tough. Like a lot of people, you know, they live out of state and they come here, and I you know, I was a mama's boy and I was, you know, lonely. I was by myself, and Joel was my brother, and Benny was my brother because Joel spoke up and said, this is a good dude, man, and Benny took me in, and whenever I would fight, you know, he would always call me and say something like, that fucker hit you harder, he hit you lower, that motherfucking, whoever said Benny didn't like the word F. Yeah, but that, he loved that word, didn't he? He loved it. He loved the 6 5. It's like it's, that was like when they taught him in school. Fuck. But anyway, I love Benny, and he was a great guy. But I had this ring my grandfather gave me, and as we left the restaurant, we walked outside. I don't know, Joel, if you remember this, but Roy Orbison, there was a show, the tribute show, was going to come up in the near future. And I gave Benny my ring, and I told him, I said, when you're singing on stage, I said, you got to hold that microphone in that hand with the diamond ring. I want to see that diamond ring, man, because that was the closest I would ever get to performing on stage, you know, is having that diamond ring. So, but he was such a proud guy, man. I mean, he talked about Robert all the time. And I'm blessed to be with you now because he talked about you like he was always with him. I think he is now. And Tommy, he talked about Tommy. He talked about Kenny, who I saw for the first time on the screen. And of course, he loved Joel. And Joel was kind of the nucleus that brought us together. And I want to thank Joel for allowing me to sit at a table for the first time with such a superstar and having a friendship that was like none other that I ever had. I think every fighter wants to be a rock star, and every rock star wants to be a fighter, and Benny loved boxing, you know, so it's no doubt that Michael became what he did. I mean, I think your father is looking down, just so proud of you, dude, you know, he talked about you so much. But I remember one time we spent in Woodstock. I was with Joel, and we were there in Woodstock, and he told me the whole story about Woodstock. I'm still in awe, man. This is years later. I'm still like, fucking, this is Benny Mardona's, man. You know, and I think he probably thought it that way about me because being a fighter and he loved boxing. But, man, that guy, I mean, he was amazing. I don't think Billy Ray Cyrus wore that mullet as good as he did, huh? I'm telling you. But anyway, I want to thank Joel for putting this together. And Tommy and your beautiful wife, thank you guys for what. It just is beautiful. And Robert, it's a pleasure to be in the same room with you, man. I mean, it really is. So, and the last thing I'm going to say is Jane, I've never seen two people more in love in my life than these two. My wife looked at these two hugging one time and says, is that the sweetest fucking thing you ever saw in your life? And she never cusses. I'm like Benny, right? The last time we were all together, we were at Benny's birthday party at Patricia's house, right? And Benny got up and sang a song, and it was like he wasn't sick at all. He was just, like somebody else said, when he got on stage, it was like being back in the 80s. I think Robert said that, or somebody said that, but it was amazing. This guy, when he got on stage, it's just like something kicked in. His natural ability just sparked, and I love that about him. And I think a lot of me as a fighter, was kind of that way. You know, when I got in front of a crowd of people, I don't care how I felt or what was on my mind, I entertained the crowd, and that's what Benny did. And so thank you all for making Benny who he was, because I think if it wasn't for everybody contributing a little bit of themselves to Benny, then Benny wouldn't have been the guy that I met. So thank you all for that. Thank you.
I had the distinct privilege and honor to sing a duet with Benny. It was a song I wrote, and my manager at the time, Greg Bell, was from Syracuse and was a huge fan of Benny Mardonis. And so when we decided we were going to make it into a duet, the first thing that came to his mind was, we gotta see if Benny Mardonis from Into the Night would sing this, because I am his biggest fan, and you know, I grew up with him. So he didn't even know Benny. He knew somebody who knew somebody who knew Benny. And, you know, because he was just like a fan looking from afar at the voice of the great man that he was. And everyone felt his heart. They knew it from the stage. So, you know, I had this super fan manager of Benny Mardonis. So he was able to reach him. And Benny, you know, said yes. And we were so excited. And I just never forget when the day he walked into the studio and he was basically helping me the whole time. Like, we got this, you got this. And really informed me and mentored me throughout the years, but starting right in that day of kind of, you know, how to be an entertainer. And of course I could never, you know, achieve what he, or, you know, reach his level of that, but it was just, you know, from always having me up on stage with him when he was doing a show, if I was in town, if I could come, he just was so generous. I mean, you've heard these stories over and over again, but artist to artist, he did not hesitate to help me at every turn, in every way, always make me feel good about myself. He knew what it was like to be an artist and feeling, you know, he was not insecure, but he knew other artists did feel insecure, so he knew how to bring me in and make me feel comfortable and encouraged, because I played some of the best shows were definitely with Benny, there's not a doubt. And to think that I was so blessed to be able to sing with him on stage, I just, you know, that is something I carry with me and I will take all my life into my grave, you know, that I was given this gift from God to sing with a man with a gift from God of his voice and his heart and his life and how he led it. And I have three kids with this wonderful man, Ken, and, it, you know, we are very dedicated parents. So as time went by, we kind of lost touch with Benny in many ways. And it's, you know, my greatest regret, people talk about, you know. And I really am sad that I didn't see him enough, and we were going to see him right before, and we missed seeing him before he passed. But I know Benny is looking down on us tonight, and I know there was no way I was going to miss being here to just tell him thank you. Thank you, Benny. We love you so much. We know that there is a beautiful voice in heaven singing like an angel to the angels, and everyone you're seeing, like Uncle Tommy that's up there in heaven with you. I'm just miss Uncle Tommy, and we were all there at his service, and I'm glad you're with Uncle Tommy. I know so many other people that you know, but thank you, Benny. I love you, and I will always be indebted to you in every single way.
Wow. I don't have much to add. I'm just here for eye candy. You know, Benny, to me, was, to all of us, really, larger than life. In fact, every time I received an email from him, it was all uppercut, you know, caps, right? So was his life, upper caps, you know? Everything was large and but present. And that's what I wanted to relate today. He was always so present for us and for our children. He'd walk in the door looking for Johnny Walker, but present from the get-go. He called me 007. I have no characteristic traits like 007, like James Bond, but he called me that so I would feel good about myself. And he found qualities in me that he, you know, that he cherished, and we had so many good times with him. I'll never forget when I Know You By Heart was released, and we were in Syracuse, and it was 6 o'clock in the morning, one of those god-awful, you know, morning shows where you can, you know, Benny would come stumbling in, you know, all of a sudden, you know, the mic would be in front of him, he's like, wham, upper caps, right? And he would deliver. Well, this morning, that particular morning, he just delivered, and we sat there and watched him going, oh my God, this guy was barely alive a minute ago, and now he's, you know, feeding the masses with his colorful, yeah, with fishes and loaves. Thank you. And so we did this morning show, I should say, my wife did, and Benny. And then Benny's like, we got to go out to the Lincoln Town Car. We got to go out. Let's go. So we hustle out. We get into the Lincoln Town Car, and we turn on the radio, and he said, here you go. Here you go. It's coming. It's coming. So did this short interview, and then for the first time, Katrina was on the radio, and I Know You By Heart came on, and Benny hugged us like it was the first time he'd ever had a song on the radio in time, and how great this man was, and how great he made us feel, and what a gift it was to be in his orbit. Benny, we love you.
My mom worked for Chasen's for 35 years, so when I took over the restaurant, I put a lot of her headshots up on the wall so that they'd have a place to live. And when Benny came into the restaurant, he asked me about them, and I told him the story, and he said, well, I'm going to be your first headshot. So he went out to his car, and he got me a picture, and of course he wrote, with love, into the night, Benny Mardones. And that is my very first personal headshot that I have on the wall, and he became my dearest friend from that moment forward. And I want to tell you, he would call me, I don't know, a couple times a week, and it wasn't it a Continental, Lincoln Continental? He'd pull up out front, he'd call me, and he'd say, come outside. So I'd come out, get in the car. And he'd put on his new song for me to listen to in the car. What do you think? What do you think? I love it. It's going to be a great album. It's going to be a great album. I love him, and I'm going to tell you, he told me when he met you, I'm going to marry her. He said that to me as well. So thank you for coming in with him, having chocolate cake, all of his favorites. I love him. Thank you.
I really love cannellinis, and I've used it to impress clients and amaze my enemies more than once. So, my name is Adam Homey. I knew Benny for about 12, 13 years. I met him in 2008 when I attended one of the fan dinners up at the Turning Stone in New York. So what happened there is I bought the ticket to the fan dinner, and I don't know how it happened, but somehow I ended up sitting right next to him at the dinner. I don't know how this happened, it just did. So fast forward about 6 months, and it's June 2009, and I'm hanging out in Los Angeles for a week. I was at my client's seminar for 3 days, and I had 3 extra days. So one of the things I did is I hung out with Benny. It was the first time he and I really got to hang out and get to know each other, which was really cool. Also, I had some clients who I'd never met in person, but they lived in Burbank, so I persuaded them that on one of the days I was there, if they could be so kind as to drive down and meet me at Cannellini's. I told them I was going to be there with a friend of mine who I identified as the mystery guest who you'll meet that day. It was going to be Benny, of course. I told Benny about it, and I told him who the two women are. And they never did. These two fairly young, very attractive women. One was blonde, one was brunette. He immediately fell in love with the brunette, which was a problem because so did I. So he made me come over to his apartment that day and help him clean the apartment. Also, I had to go to ice cream shopping with him, and he had to buy 6 different flavors of ice cream because he had this idea he was going to bring them back to his place. Now, Jane, this was 6 months before you came into the picture. You're safe. And then he also worked out a code with me. He said, pal, when we're down at Cannellini's, if I say, hey, I wonder what Marty's doing, because Marty lived right upstairs at the time, that's a sign to wrap it up and get out of there. But if he started telling a story about his 26-pound calico cat named
Butters,
then that meant that he approved. So these two women walk in. Now remember, I hadn't met them in person. I just knew their pictures. The shorter one was 6'3". And so they sit down at the table, and he insisted, we were meeting at 7, he insisted he and I be there at 6:30. So we've been waiting for a while. And they're barely seated, and he looks in and says, ladies, do you like cats? That's the first one. The second one is, this is a few months later, and by this time I bought up some Benny Mardones merch. So I had sweatshirts, I had those sweatpants with the logo on them, the scarf and everything else. And I was grocery shopping, and some young fashion-conscious woman came up to me and asked me about, who's that designer, Benny Mardones? I said, it's Mardones. He has some independent stuff. He has a website, and he does things with his fans every once in a while. Look him up on the internet, and you can buy some of his stuff. So I told him the story about that. I said, I told her you're a fashion designer. And he said, pal, whatever you need to say to get laid, use my name, however you need. And he arranged for me to get the command performance, which will matter to me for the rest of my life. Thank you. And thank all of you.
Say, and this is no secret, a lot of people refer to Benny as a one-hit wonder.
Oh, yeah, really?
Right? So, just to let you know, there were only 8 recording artists in Billboard history to ever chart twice on the Billboard charts. And Benny took his place in that 8. And he was with Chubby Checker, The Twist, Queen, Bohemian Rhapsody, Neil Sedaka, Breaking Up His Heart. Benny was one of the eight. And then in 2019, as you saw in one of the videos I played, Benny stepped away from the Pack of Eight, as I call it, with his third version of Into the Night, which I had the honor of producing also. And by the way, just to let you know, Benny is now in consideration for the Guinness World Book of Records.
Yay!
And the only artist ever to chart three times, same song, different decades, and with Benny, different centuries now. Okay? Well, it doesn't stop here, Jane.
Hi, I'm Rudy Perez. I can't believe it's been a year since Benny left us. But in my experience, greats like Benny never leave, because their songs live in our hearts forever. Today, exactly 1 year after his passing, I join his family and friends to celebrate his life and his extraordinary career. Shortly before his passing, I had the privilege of speaking with Benny on the phone. And during that conversation, Benny asked me to do a new version of Into the Night with someone, he said. Of course, I promised I would. So together with our good friend and Benny's mentor, Joel Diamond, I went to work. I am so happy to announce that Benny's last wish has come true. This year, his very last performance of his timeless song, Into the Night, will be released globally in all platforms as a duet with Julio Iglesias Jr. Julio will also be releasing a Spanish version of the song. One last thing to Benny's beloved wife, Jane. I want you to know that during that last phone call, Benny told me how grateful he was for your love and that you were his angel on earth. I was very touched by that, especially knowing that Benny is now your guardian angel in heaven. Long live Benny Mardones, the voice.
Benny Mardones' performance on Into the Night is now, as Rudy Perez said, Rudy and I produced it together, along with Julio Iglesias Jr., being released with a huge promotional push. And there's no question it's going to be destined to be on the Billboard charts. So, in conclusion, let's see anybody even come close to matching not this one-hit wonder, but instead, the four-hit one.
Ooh.
take you into the night.